Learning medicine is hard work. Osmosis makes it easy. It takes your lectures and notes to create a personalized study plan with exclusive videos, practice questions, and flashcards, and so much more. Try it free today.
Few laboratory techniques have drawn quite as much attention to themselves as CRISPR-Cas9 has, and on some level, everybody has heard of what this tool can do. Gene editing, or put simply, tweaking DNA. With gene editing, targeted changes are made, like deletions and insertions, right in an organism's genome. Over the past decade, the CRISPR-Cas9 system has become a very popular method of genome editing because it's fast, cheap, precise, and relatively easy to use. Now, on a molecular level, DNA is made up of two strands of nucleotides, so each gene is just a segment of this nucleotide sequence. Nucleotides of DNA are made out of a sugar, deoxyribose, a phosphate, and one of the four nucleobases, adenine, cytosine, guanine, and thymine, or A, C, G, T for short. The nucleotides on one strand pair up using hydrogen bonds with nucleotides on the opposing strand to create the double-stranded DNA. Specifically, A bonds with T and C bonds with G, so they're called complementary bases and form base pairs. Now, a single strand of DNA can also form bonds with a single strand of RNA made out of a sugar, ribose, a phosphate, and one of the four nucleobases, but RNA has uracil, U for short, instead of T. So when complementary sequences in DNA and RNA bond, A bonds with U. In other words, if the DNA has a sequence that reads 5' GGCTAT 3', then the RNA sequence is exactly the opposite and reads 3' CCGAUA 5'. Now, occasionally, double-stranded breaks in the genome occur, and when they do, the cell has two main repair mechanisms to correct the damage. The most common type is non-homologous end joining, where a protein complex called DNA protein kinase begins by binding to each end of the broken DNA. It then recruits another protein called Artemis, named after the Greek goddess, to cut off the single-stranded ends. It's like using a tiny bit of sandpaper to smooth the broken ends of a pencil so that the pencil can be more easily glued together again. Finally, a ligase enzyme, which would be the glue, binds the two ends of DNA. Since Artemis cuts off some nucleotides, non-homologous end joining is an error-prone repair that leads to a loss of genetic information. The other repair mechanism is called homology-directed repair, which relies on homologous recombination. Our 46 chromosomes come in 23 pairs of two homologous chromosomes, which code for the same traits, and therefore have similar nucleotide sequences. As a result, a double-stranded break on one of the chromosomes can be repaired by using the sister chromatid. First, a protein complex, called mRNA, binds to each end of the broken DNA and recruits exonucleases that remove nucleotides from one strand of the DNA. To make the process more clear, we can call the ends of the broken DNA end1 and end2. So now, end1 is placed near a similar nucleotide sequence called the homologous sequence because it's found in the same spot on the homologous sister chromatid. End1 then pairs up with a complementary strand of the intact homologous DNA region, creating a loop in the homologous DNA. Then, a DNA polymerase synthesizes nucleotides to extend end1 until it reaches a sequence that's complementary to end2. Then, end1 releases the homologous DNA and its last few nucleotides bind to the last nucleotides of end2. Finally, DNA polymerase fills the gaps on both sides of the union, and DNA ligase seals the bond. Since homology-directed repair uses a sister chromatid as a template, this is a more reliable repair mechanism than non-homologous end joining because there's no loss of nucleotides. Okay, so CRISPR is an abbreviation for clustered, regularly interspaced, short palindromic repeats, a mouthful that means that within some prokaryotes, like bacteria and archaea, there are certain locations in the genome where one particular DNA sequence is repeated over and over again. And in between these repeats are unique sequences, called spacers. Then, near these CRISPR locations are cluster-associated, or Cas, proteins, many of which have enzymatic activity. While there are several types of Cas genes, the one that's claimed the most fame is Cas9 because of its usefulness in the CRISPR-Cas gene editing system. Cas9 is a DNA endonuclease, so that means it can cut DNA, like a pair of molecular scissors. Now, it turns out that the spacers in CRISPR locations are kind of a historical record of DNA viruses that have previously infected the host. So, when a DNA virus gets into a host cell, certain fragments of it, called protospacers, are incorporated into the host's genome, becoming the spacers in CRISPR locations. In a way, they become a molecular record, kind of like a database of mugshots of previous viral offenders. When a CRISPR location is transcribed into RNA, it forms a pre-CRISPR RNA, or pre-CR RNA for short, made up of the complement sequences of both the spacers and repeats. And at the bits of repeat complements that are 3' to the spacer complements, another RNA, transactivating CRISPR RNA, or tracker RNA for short, binds. Together, they recruit enzymes that chop the pre-CRISPR RNA into smaller pieces and trim the 5' ends of those pieces. What's left are mature CRISPR RNAs, each made of the complements to both the 3' repeat and about 20 nucleotides of a spacer, still bound to tracker RNA. Now, let's say that the virus returns to that cell. Well, Cas9 recognizes a specific protospacer-adjacent motif, or PAM for short, which is a conserved 2-5 base pair sequence located near the CRISPR RNA complementary sequence. And if the CRISPR RNA tracker RNA complex binds to its complementary sequence near a PAM, it helps guide Cas9 to chop up the double-stranded DNA of the offender like a ninja, 3 base pairs in front of the PAM. This causes destruction of the virus. In the end, the CRISPR-Cas system is an evolutionary adaptation against DNA viral infections. But the basic parts of this system can be manipulated and used in a variety of eukaryotic organisms and cell types. To date, the CRISPR-Cas9 system has been used in several organisms, including mice, monkeys, and most recently in humans, and has been able to make modifications in somatic cells, including stem cells, and even germline cells, which can then transmit the engineered changes across generations. A few modifications have been made to the system for its use in this range of organisms and cells. For starters, the components of CRISPR-Cas need to be delivered to the cell that normally would not have these components in its genome. And there are several delivery methods, each with their own strengths, weaknesses, and efficiencies in different cell types. But whichever method is used, it delivers Cas9, an RNA fusion of CRISPR RNA and tracker RNA, called a single guide RNA, or sgRNA, or simply gRNA, and a kind of zip code sequence that delivers these components to the nucleus of the host cell. Once there, the single guide RNA scans the genome looking for the complement of its target sequence. When it binds, Cas9 ninja chops the double-stranded DNA near a PAM. Okay, great. Now you have a gap in the genome of the host, and this is where the editing magic happens using the host cell's own DNA repair mechanisms. So, if the double-stranded break is repaired with non-homologous end joining, there will be a loss of the complementary sequence with no replacement. But let's say you want to put new genetic information in that spot, like if you wanted to swap a mutated beta-globin gene for sickle cell disease for a normal beta-globin gene to cure the disease, then it's possible to do that with homology-directed repair. To do this, the normal donor DNA would need to be delivered to the host cell. That donor DNA will act like a sister chromatid as a reference to recreate the lost genetic information. Okay, but let's say you don't want to edit out a gene or even replace it. You just want to silence a gene for a little while and figure out what it does. Well, then a faulty or inducible Cas9 protein can be used that has lost its ability to chop the DNA. So that means when Cas9 sits down on the target gene, it just chills there and prevents its transcription. Alright, as a quick recap. The CRISPR-Cas9 system naturally occurs in prokaryotes to acquire adaptive immunity against DNA viruses. But the system has been altered for use in a variety of species and eukaryotic cells. In these cells, a single guide RNA targets a specific part of the genome and guides endonuclease Cas9 to make a double-stranded break. Breaks are repaired using host cell repair mechanisms, including non-homologous end joining, where there's a loss of genetic information, or homology-directed repair, where donor DNA introduces a new sequence into the genome.
Thanks for watching. If you're interested in a deeper dive on this topic, take a look at osmosis.org, where we have flashcards, questions, and other awesome tools to help you learn medicine.